Well, the South Tangipahoa Port Commission heard at their meeting on Tuesday that there may be some problems, at least substantial delays in proposals to turn much of the acreage at the port into recreational use. Pat Dufrene is the port director, and, you know, you're not really surprised to hear this.
Well, Ken, we've tried to explore for quite some time now a multi-use game plan at the port. We've got a industrial client that's got a 30-year lease, so we've been looking to incorporate the recreational component around that issue. Most recently, or first of all, we looked into a linear park concept next to the Interstate 55. There seems to be a lot of right-of-way issues that the DOTD deals with in terms of facilitating the federal rules. So in terms of the park concept that our architect had put together, there are a lot of possibilities, but there are actually more unknowns and knowns at this point. In terms of mitigation issues, Corps of Engineer permitting issues, there are some liability issues. So per the meeting we just had, I think we're making good progress in terms of the R&D that has to take place before we actually make any sort of decisions or investment.
It sounds like you didn't get really any encouragement from the highway department.
Well, you know, I've been dealing with DOTD in the port business for quite some time. And, you know, in terms of the federal regulations, they have a protocol that they have to mandate in terms of the interstate system all over the country. There are some recreational facilities that have been installed along Highway 51, most notably all the way out in St. John Parish, that have been in place for 20, 30 years. The concept would be to duplicate that in some way. The issue going forward is whether some of those facilities should ever been put there in the first place in terms of the maintenance and the liability issues. So it seems to be a lot more difficult in 2021 to begin this process of the recreational component than possibly 20, 30 years ago.
Is there any acreage at the port, though, that you could use for recreation other than the DOTD right-of-way?
We're looking into the concept of doing that. The issue is while the port is still primarily an industrial park in terms of a chemical manufacturing operation, we also have rail car storage. So on a given day, we have, in addition to rail car movements, truck movements. So the issue is in terms of keeping the pedestrian side away from the industrial side going forward. As previously just discussed in the meeting just now, the port pays a lot of insurance in addition to any client insurance that companies pay there. So those are all things that have to be discussed in terms of liability.
Well, what's at the port now?
We've got our primary port tenant is a company by the name of Premier Chemicals, and they are a chemical blending operation. They primarily make water purification products. They make paper additives. They make cleaning solutions. And they bring in bulk materials by rail and blend them in storage tanks inside the building. And they ship them out primarily by truck.
So do you have any other prospects on the industry front?
Premier Chemicals is basically utilized in both buildings. From time to time, we'll get an inquiry about possibly adding another facility there. We don't have natural gas at the port. That's sort of an inhibiting factor in terms of a big manufacturing company. But we do have available land for storage.
How much land do you have that's available?
We've got about 20 acres that's buildable today. We've got an additional 20 that could be put into play in terms of outside of the 100 acres on the eastern and northern side of the facility, that we have a cooperative endeavor agreement with the Octavia Group that owns the property. But there would be a mitigation fee related to putting that property into play.
Even if it was for recreation?
Yes. Anytime a wetlands area is put into play, it doesn't make any difference what it is. That acreage that's going to be taken out has to be compensated for in terms of a mitigation bank somewhere else.
Well, a surprise I learned at this meeting is just how profitable it's been for the port to start holding rail cars for storage. And that's a revenue stream. I guess nobody saw it coming, but it's a good one.
It's a great advantage to be located directly adjacent to the Canadian National Railroad. The largest railroad company in North America has more track than any company in North America. It touches the Atlantic, Pacific coast in Canada, comes down to the Gulf Coast. So it makes a T in North America. Here's more track in North America. So having access to the main line allows more companies to deliver their rail cars for storage, not having to use and pay an additional railroad as a connector.
So let's talk dollars. I mean, did I hear right? $350 per car per day?
Per month.
Per month.
Yes.
$350 per car per month.
Per month. Yes. And per discussion at the meeting, basically, if a port facility has enough space to park the cars where they're not moved or need to be moved during a particular given time, it's basically the port has to very little effort to accommodate the cars.
So how many can you hold?
We can store approximately 60 rail cars at a time with the amount of storage track we have. Some of the track space primarily for our primary tenant has to be left open so they can move cars in and out as needed. If some of the cars can be moved by the port's trackmobile, depending on where they are, but depending on where the car is, it would have to be moved by the Canadian National Locomotive, which would result in a fee for that movement.
But that's thousands of dollars a month to the port.
Yes, it is. It is. So, in terms of discussion of rail, it could be advantageous in the port in a future project to install even more track, which would allow to accept more cars. It's obviously profitable once the storage space is made available.
It just seems as though when you go in the direction of recreation, you come across the Corps of Engineers, the state of Louisiana, wetlands problems. I mean, it's not an easy task.
No, it's a multi-problem issue in terms of the pre-planning. Everything can look very creative and on paper. But in terms of anything near a wetlands facility, is going to be highly permitted on the federal and state level.
What if local lawmakers, the governor, what if some political muscle got behind the idea of creating a park at Manchac? Certainly that could help you jump the hurdles of the highway department.
It never hurts to have a political team on your side of an issue. It just seems to be in today's climate. Political support is only one part of the pyramid that needs to be constructed. The permitting issues are a monumental hurdle to climb for any project in this area.
You know, there are people hearing this that they're going to think it's easier to get a permit to put an industry at Manchac than it is to get a park there.
it's a liability issue. It's a liability issue, and a lot of those programs are in place for good reasons. You know, they want to protect the environment, but in terms of planning, you always need to start way ahead of time in terms of your target range, due to the amount of research that has to take place.
What else are you working on?
Well, we're always looking to develop the property there. We're always trying to utilize any company that would need access to a barge, rail, or truck. Sometimes there are short-term storage projects. We're currently hosting an energy for a short-term storage project. But it's got to be the right fit for the right company and their operations to come and operate it at the terminal.
So you've not closed the door on barges?
You know, we've got a couple of $1 million in barge docks there. The facility of the port industry is the container. We've been in discussions with the Port of New Orleans for quite some time, and even facilitating empty containers. Expansion of the Panama Canal has allowed bigger ships to come to the Gulf. The Mississippi River dredging program that's going to take place with the additional funding to go from 45 to 50 feet is going to allow bigger ships to come to the Gulf. Some of these ships can hold 15,000, 20,000 TEUs, the 20-foot or 40-foot storage boxes. As a result of that, you're going to need distribution places to store or reload the containers, either going up north by rail or back overseas. So that's the long-term plans in terms of the port industry and the Ports Association, the research that we've been receiving from them in the past 10 years or so. And that's also incorporated in the Ports Master Plan in terms of the industrial side.
It takes more than one person to assist in a personal injury claim. I am attorney Glenn Westmoreland, and we have a strong team at the Mack Law Firm. It is our goal to make sure your injury is properly attended to. Contact me at tangilawteam.com and let us get you the help you need.